Hey guys, the Trekyard team has returned. And today, in addition to myself, Captain Foley, we have the ever so lovely Samuel Cockings.
Hello.
And our good friend Rick Sternbach to entertain you with another Trekyards briefing.
Hi,
guys. Welcome to the show, Rick.
Hey, yeah.
Now, as usual, this is just a briefing and behind-the-scenes look at the design of this iconic Star Trek staple. We will let you know what it is in just a quick minute, but all the in-depth stats and facts about this item will be detailed and discussed during its very own Trekyards Legends episode, coming along sometime in the future. But for now, we will just scratch the surface and give you a little teaser.
And since, Mr. Steinbeck, you're on the show, let's discuss your very popular, I think it's fair to say iconic, space station. That being the Cardassian space station orbiting Bajor, probably guessed it by now, Terok Nor, otherwise known as to the humans, Deep Space Nine.
So, Rick, when did you get the news that there was to be a new Star Trek show set in the frontier of space, taking place almost exclusively on an alien space station? And can you please tell us the initial ideas that they had regarding its design? What was the first note that you got about Deep Space Nine?
Yeah, well, you know, we heard about the new series while Next Generation was still, you know, in production, during the seventh season. I have some Next Generation scripts which have DS9 doodles in them. So,
cool.
we began getting. Some memos, not exactly like a full writer's guide or anything like that, but we did get bits and pieces of news from the production office that yes, they were going to be doing a second show. I couldn't tell you exactly which season of Next Gen this was, around 1992 or so, little bits of news would come out of the production office. They were going to put together a whole separate art department, but I was on Next Generation I worked with Herman Zimmerman, who was, Herman was our first season Next Generation production designer. They brought Herman back to do, Deep Space Nine. And, I contributed, designs for maybe the first three seasons, and then got heavily into Voyager. So working two shows at once is not the easiest thing in the world, and not surprisingly, they took me off DS9 to work exclusively on Voyager. But while Deep Space Nine was in its early stages, I worked up designs. Mike Okuda worked up some designs. We had regular meetings with Herman, with Rick Berman, very early on, we didn't have a total sense of just what the station was. I mean, there were producer notes about the station possibly being, an abandoned alien facility that the Cardassians simply took over. Mm-hmm. These kind of little story things, they pop up, they get written out, the story crystallizes, a little more here and there. Finally, it was a Cardassian station. The only real design cues that we had were the Cardassian uniforms and the Galor class, Cardassian ship.
Which leads directly into my next question, not to cut you off, but let's go straight into that. So obviously we know you designed Cardassian Galor class, and that was mostly in TNG and then obviously promptly in DS9. And that really was, as you say, with the uniform as well, you designed the original Cardassian aesthetic. So what did you take from the Galore and what did you bring forward from the Cardassian aesthetic to help put together Deep Space Nine?
The Galore class, you know, it really, it contributed not a great deal to the overall look of the station, okay? Except maybe in the fact that, you know, it was a different, you know, it was something different from Starfleet, you know, and we talked about this before that you know, the different alien races had, you know, very definite, specific, stylistic elements. The station went through so many versions, so many preliminary sketches, and, you know, Okuda and I put together a lot of CG models, very rough, grayscale CG shapes, okay? And we just went at this for the longest time. Some of the suggestions or some of the ideas that the producers had, you know, talked about things like, okay, the space equivalent of an offshore oil platform. Okay, something big and industrial and, you know, full of docking ports. And yeah, so we went at that for a while. We actually produced a foam core and plastic model bits of rough model of this oil platform sort of thing. And the producers looked at it and, you know, we give them a lot of these rough ideas so that they can home in on shapes that they like, mm-hmm. Things that might work with the stories that they were coming up with. Even though the oil platform shape really didn't resonate with them, there were pieces of it that started to work. Mm-hmm. The central core of that oil platform eventually developed into the central core of a rough model that had a lot of shielding, sort of a command center on top, you know, docking facilities underneath, power station, you know, a big power plant at the base. And that core, those core elements, survived through to the final design with little tweaks here and there. Mm-hmm. You know, it was another one of these things, another one of these designs where we threw all kinds of shapes together. We got approvals, we got some, you know, rejections. We went at it again, and it turned into the station.
Well, that kind of leads into my next question. Like, exactly how long were you working on designing the station? Like, how much lead time did you get? Was it only a few weeks, or were you given more time, considering this is going to be a hero?
You know, it was a few months. It was months.
Because in our research, we found three early concept stations, which will appear next to us while we're talking here. Mm-hmm. But feel free to talk about each of these and how you developed the design into the DS9 we saw on screen.
Yeah. Well, the central core that I started to flesh out, you know, pieces were added, pieces were taken away. Mike suggested some terracing, some stepped shapes, which, you know, to me sounded like, okay, some very interesting deck divisions, you know, in the station. Herman Zimmerman came up with, you know, an idea that, you know, maybe this thing could be the sort of classical wheeled space station that rotated. And, you know, as I mentioned before, we had to remind Herman, we have artificial gravity, okay? We don't have to rotate the station. But Rick Berman said that you know, like the Enterprise, this had to be a shape that people could understand quickly and easily, and any kid, you know, could draw in a couple of strokes. Mm-hmm. And that's how we ended up with, keeping the core, but adding the big docking ring around the outside, docking ring, habitat ring, defensive hardware.
It's clear to see from the original sketches that are next to us, the first two are very much like, say, your platform, and the third is definitely that ring, and then obviously the final one. You can see that development into that side, and it definitely improves, I think.
I did a series of slightly more refined grayscale computer models, very rough 3D models. I put a very rough Enterprise D into the same scene. I had one version of this thing where the pylons, the shapes that were eventually going to become the docking pylons, were actually full hoops, okay, that were crisscrossed, kind of like, you know, a classical model of an atom, you know, with the electron, you know, rings going around. And Rick Berman said, break them. Break those rings, okay. And that was one of the final suggestions, you know, to make this thing, a circular, a big circular space station with lots of hardware in the core. And the broken rings became the docking pylons. And once that started to gel in 3D and then in a bunch of pen and ink sketches, okay, then I just went crazy with detail. Tony Meininger and Brazil Fabrication, they were charged with building the six-footer, the big six-foot miniature. With anybody who's going to build, you know, a physical miniature, I will give them as much detail as I possibly can. Right down to little pipes, graphite plates around the power plant.
That scuff where the original designer hit his shoe, and it's just detail, yeah.
Once the producers were happy with the basic shape,
yeah.
Okay, then the styling and the engineering converged, and we had input from from the set designers on DS9. I think Joe Hodges came up with the flared out bases to the pylons.
Cardassian's necks.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, and as Herman said, you know, in a number of interviews, we started to think like Cardassians. A lot of the shapes that you see on the station ended up in places like the promenade, you know, but the exterior of the station, the plating became Cardassian. Ricardo Delgado contributed, you know, some stylistic sketches, and he did some great stuff on the interiors too. But I just started tearing into lots and lots of Cardassian style plus plausible engineering. We had the runabout pads. We had the defensive sail towers, the promenade section, exteriors with the windows. Okay, and in a lot of cases, we have set windows. We match them on the outside. You get people thinking, okay, interior, exterior, and they can see how that styling all works. You can't see a full-size Cardassian window that's only going to be like an eighth of an inch on the miniature, okay? But you get a lot of the shapes going. You get those flared bases. You get the pylons had a particular kind of curve. And look what they did with that sort of styling in things like the mat shots of the Cardassian cities.
Absolutely.
You see a lot of that.
Yeah.
So that styling ran throughout the series. And it was, you know, we had a great time with it.
Like I said earlier, you definitely built this aesthetic from the ground up. But back to the station itself. So Deep Space Nine was not the first station we saw. We'd seen Regular One and obviously the gigantic Earth space dock. But how did you approach the scale of the station? I mean, how big did you think it should be? And what sort of instructions did you get in that regard? And obviously, how do you feel about some of the scale problems that we see cropping up with some of the VFX shots with the different ships around them? I mean, why make it that big or why make it that small, as it were?
I think my blueprints to Tony Meininger's guys, my blueprints had the station pegged at about 3,600 feet in diameter. You know, some of those effect shots, you know, with things like the Enterprise D, with ships like the Defiant, with ships like the Burrell class, Bird of Prey, okay? You know, visual effects, they don't have a constant scale in the miniatures. Okay, Defiant was a big miniature. Okay, so they had to scale it down. Visual effects had their own internal set of scale sizes. Okay, they pegged Deep Space Nine at 5,280 feet. Okay, that's an Earth mile. Okay, but I think for them, it gave them a starting point. It gave them a size. By the time we got to the Deep Space Nine technical manual, I had split the difference between 3,600 and 5,200 and made it around 4,300 something feet in diameter. It kind of works. You know, it's not perfect. But what are you going to do? You know, it is what it is. I think the middle figure that we published in the tech manual, I think works with a little bit of rubber banding. Mm-hmm. And you know, there's really, you know, there's no reason to get crazy about it, because there's so many other, you know, really interesting bits and pieces, you know, connected with the station itself.
Mm. Yeah. But then why did you originally make it that large, and why not maybe five times larger? Why did you peg that size as the perfect size for a Cardassian space station for the home of these characters?
I think I picked the original 3,600 feet simply because I think visually it felt correct. Okay, if you made it two times as big, four times as big, you would end up with, let's say, the ops module being almost invisible.
Yeah.
Mm. All right. So mentally, you know, you have to kind of like, you know, work out the size. And in the detail drawings that I gave to Brazil Fabrication, you know, I made the shapes, you know, large enough to be visible. Okay, and so you could see the engineering bits, you could see the styling, the plate details, the windows, the window lighting, okay, all of that stuff. If we made it way too big, you know, a lot of that stuff would have gotten lost. If we made it really, really small, you know, what's the point of having a space station that's, you know, that's not much bigger than a starship?
Yeah.
Awesome.
You know, so we worked it out.
Sounds good.
Now, Deep Space Nine, or its true name, Terok Nor, what was it like fully fleshing out a whole alien space station? We had, of course, seen many detailed Klingon interiors over the years, but nothing to compare to every set on DS9. at least for the first few seasons before the Defiant showed up. But what was it like designing like a Cardassian and staying completely distinct from the Federation style? Did you miss the classics at any point? Or did you not want to go back to restricting yourself to Starfleet style after a while?
Since I only did the exterior of the station and you know, a handful of props over three seasons, anytime I can do something alien and distinct from Starfleet, you know, it's always terrific. Starfleet style, you know, was super well established on Next Gen. When I got a chance to design the Klingon attack cruiser, the Vorcha, okay, that was a stylistic, change. Mm-hmm. The Galor class was a nice change. Terok Nor was a great opportunity to create shapes that made engineering sense, but were done differently. It's science fiction, but I go back and I look at things like, look at the engineering style of Russian spacecraft and Russian boosters. Boy, are they different. A lot of Soviet era, planetary spacecraft that they sent to Mars, they sent to Venus. You cannot mistake those for, Western style engineering. Okay, so the same kind of thing came up in Deep Space Nine. Okay, what would the outside of Ops look like? Okay, what does a Cardassian shield generator look like? Okay, not like Starfleet. So that's how I proceeded with all of the exterior stuff. You can see shapes that, performed a certain function, but they weren't Starfleet shapes. Okay, somebody else's solution to an engineering problem.